about missionary work, because, you know, the gospel is always there. We're trying to bring that gospel to everyone out there. But it's also important.
Yeah, that's what I
said, everyone. I said everyone, Bishop. But yes, this includes both Relief Society and the Elders Forum and everybody here, right? We have a lot of brethren that I've seen coming by that, you know, it's just important that we reach out to these people. We make sure that they're loved and that they feel welcome when they come back to the church. It's just something that's important, because there's a, so Senator Dina mission, we have a goal of 660 baptisms this year, which is double last year at 300, and they added a little bit more on top. But I think it's just something that, you know, has been on my mind lately, is just to minister, to reach out to people you haven't seen in a while. Maybe you check up on a friend you haven't seen in that church or at FHG or institute in a while. Just try to reach out to these people, make sure that they feel loved, they know that we think about them, and that they're welcome to come join us anytime. And I think it's just something that we can easily forget about at times. We get into the, I feel like we get into the rhythm of only hanging out with our little groups of friends, which is okay. But never forget that we still have brethren that are out there and they need a friend. And we, it's up to us to be that friend for those people. Because it's just, there's three important things too that I want to remind you guys about, which, you know, is our word mission plan, is to love, share, and invite. You know, these are things that you hear about all the time. They're very simple, but because they're simple, they're easy to figure out, like how I said. So just, I invite you guys to figure out ways that you can show love in your life to other people. You can invite people to come out to activities, or, you know, share a little message about the gospel, or even your testimony. Just try to find ways you can do that in everyday life, especially to those that I said that are maybe less active, you know, probably need a little bit of help trying to come back to the Lord or the church, either or. But, you know, I know that if we do these things, Heavenly Father will bless us accordingly, because we have a lot of people coming into the church. We have a lot of people coming by, investigators and stuff, friends of the missionaries. And if we do these things, Heavenly Father will bless us, and He'll allow these people to see the good in the gospel and they'll want to stay here, and they will want to partake of the gospel and the word of the Savior. And I know these things are true, and I just hope you guys can pray about opportunities to do all these things and just to be that friend to those people. I do this with you all in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
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 Introduction to the book of Acts is that this highlights major missionary efforts of the
June. There is opposition, and we'll see, because we have two videos that will be shown. There are people who refuse to accept the testimony of the brethren. We will also meet who Stefan is, and we'll learn of his martyrdom. I will expand on this more. But I just want to mention that this is part of the gradual growth of the church in its early days. This is the growth and the spreading of the gospel to Jews, to non-Jewish Israelites, to non-Israelites, and then we're also introduced to Saul, who is fallen, to sum it up, it just opens the door for the worldwide extension of the gospel, baptism, of bearing testimony and establishing the church and the demands that these disciples can reach. So I am eager to be starting this. And in chapter 1, this is where Jesus ministers for 40 days after his resurrection, and he talks about how the kingdom is to be restored to Israel at a later time. The 12 are to bear witness in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the other most parts of the earth. And then this is also where Jesus is descended into heaven, and Matthias is chosen to fill the vacancy in the 12. So we have so much to cover, and if this was my idea, I would conduct this like a college class, and we would do a thorough analysis between the Old Testament and New Testament, so that you can fully understand why there was so much contention in this time, why the gospel needed to be shared with others, and the understanding and the comprehension of the law of Moses and how Christ fulfilled it. So if I can have a couple readers, right now if we can turn to the book of Acts, okay, we'll do Selena, Jackie, and then Vivian. Okay, so Selena, will you read the chapter heading for chapter 2 in the book of Acts, and then Jackie, you can do chapter 3. And then Ruben, you can read the chapter heading for chapter 4. And then who else? We need a couple more readers. Who's willing to read the chapter heading for 5? Okay, go ahead.
You said chapter heading for 2?
Yes.
The Spirit is poured out upon the day of Pentecost.
Mm-hmm.
Peter testifies of Jesus' resurrection. He tells how the king's salvation and speaks of the gift of the Holy Ghost. Many believe and are baptized.
Peter and John heal a man lame since birth. Peter preaches repentance. He also speaks of the age of restoration preceding the second coming. He identifies Christ as the prophet of whom Moses spoke.
Peter and John are arrested and brought before the council. Peter testifies that salvation comes because of Christ. The Sadducees strive to silence Peter and John. The saints glory in the testimony of Jesus. They have all things in common.
Ananias and Sapphira are with the Lord and with God. The apostles continue to hear about Jesus. Peter and John are rescued, and they go to the Lord and they testify to Christ. In a new year of Matthew,
was that chapter 5
then?
Yeah. Okay. So, we've heard a lot of different parts to this because we have so much ground to cover. I wanted to make it brief. But there's a couple very important things to mention about the Holy Ghost. We learn a lot about the Holy Ghost in the book of Acts. We learn about the day of Pentecost. And this is related to the law of Moses, and it was to celebrate the harvest, so the first fruits of the harvest. It was also called the Feast of the Harvest in the Old Testament, and it's also where males of the covenant people needed to appear before the Lord. So this is very significant because of the Passover in the book of Exodus. This is when God smote the firstborn of the Egyptians before they were going to be led out to freedom. Remember, the Israelites were in captivity in the book of Exodus. So I wanted to bring this up because there's so many different ideas right now during this time after Jesus was crucified. So Jesus is ascending into heaven, and people were kind of questioning, like, what can we do next? What are, you know, like, they were expecting the Savior to be this military person, like someone who's going to come in and slay the Roman Empire, and that they were going to be brought to justice. And they were kind of looking for, like, the Savior to be someone who's going to cause war and all this havoc. But we saw that that was completely the opposite of what Jesus did. Jesus actually was a servant. He was humble. He was helping people. So I think that that is something that when we're talking about the Savior's atonement, like his resurrection, how we can be like Christ, I think it's challenging a lot of our own views that we may have that come from the world, of how we're supposed to treat each other. And it also challenges a lot of the things that were taught in the Old Testament under the law of Moses. So, this is a depiction of the day of Pentecost, and another important part to mention was that many of these people were converted and they actually got baptized. And I think in the scriptures it cited about 3,000 except for that invitation by Peter. So what happens with Peter is he does spread the gospel with boldness. He does share his testimony of Jesus Christ. But as Peter preaches, he is arrested. So we are going to watch this depiction and hopefully I can get this to work.
Opponents, we have made this man to walk. The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, hath glorified his Son Jesus, whom he delivered up and denied him the presence of Pilate, but he was determined to let it go. And this man, through faith in his name, hath been made strong, whom he see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him hath given him this perfect silence in the presence of the Lord. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was preached unto you, whom ye have crucified, whom the heaven must receive until the time of restitution of all things, which God hath spoken by the mouth of all his holy prophets since the world began. For Moses truly said unto the fathers, the prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like unto me. Him shall he hear in all things, whatsoever he shall say unto you.
Take him.
Ye are the children of the prophets, and of the covenant which God made with our fathers. Say unto Abraham, and in thy seed shall all the kindreds of the earth be blessed. Unto you first, God having raised up his Son Jesus, sent him to bless you, and turn away every one of you from his name.
He's bearing his testimony of Christ, and he does this with boldness, and we see that the Holy Ghost can inspire us to act on what we learn in the gospel. Maybe you, sometimes in your life, have acted on inspiration from your own study of the Word of God to share with someone else. So my question to you is, what does it mean to speak the Word of God with boldness? Take a moment to think about that. And we're going to open up a discussion. What does it mean to speak the Word of God with boldness? No.
To speak the Word of God in case of a person.
That even when you are facing a contention and adversity, that you're still willing to share the gospel.
I think it's what someone else says, be a peacemaker. A lot of people with different opinions and beliefs and things that might not be morally correct or things that are different from us. But when we become a peacemaker, we stand boldly as a witness of Christ, being able to make peace, for us to be able to not bend to the will of man, to stand strong to God's standards and to let everyone choose for themselves.
Mm-hmm. In this moment, Peter has this task of leading this effort to teach all the nations, right? So I think when we look at that, it's like, what about times when we feel inadequate or when we feel afraid? How are we willing to step out on faith and to share the Word of God? And being bold, even though we know there are times when prophets have been persecuted for sharing their own testimony. Anyone else?
I think the greatest success we have in sharing the gospel is to those that we know about me, our friends.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe that there's a component of boldness in when the Spirit speaks to you to share to his body that you've already loved to speak up. And it's not like shouting from the rooftops, it's just saying, hey, come to church with me tomorrow.
Exactly. You know what? That goes back to what Isaac was saying, when you love sharing with light, you can invite someone to attend a church activity. And maybe that is then accepting an invitation to come to Christ, to accept the gospel in your life.
I'm going with what Edwards and Noah have said. I feel like instead of us being scared to want to invite someone to share or to speak scripture or to an activity or something, like, just give it a shot. We don't have to play God. All we have to do is just have faith that what's the word you can say, no thanks, I'm okay, and hope for the best. But I think speaking the Word of God is just having the courage to just telling someone that God is there for them no matter what, that no matter what's happening, he's going to get us through it. Because some people, when you hear the Word of God, sometimes you have this fear of them pushing back because of how their faith is. So I think instead of being afraid to speak about God or to invite people to things, we're just there for them and just extend an invite and hope for the best. And if they do, then great, and they get to experience what we get to experience on a daily basis.
You know, in my notes I put that reading about the gospel, it seems easy. And some principles are easy to apply, like being kind to our neighbor, being more forgiving. But for others, it can be really difficult, and I think people still can change and can improve their lifestyle, their choices. But we do have to be careful that we're not being forceful, because they have their agency to choose. Anyone else? So we're going to move on to chapters 6 through 9 in the book of Acts, and we have four readers to read through the chapter heading here. Okay, will you read chapter 6 heading?
Okay.
And actually, you can do chapter 6 and chapter 7 heading.
The apostles chose Stephen to assist them. Stephen is tried before the council. Stephen recounts the history of Israel and names Moses as the prototype of Jesus of Christ. He testifies of the apostasy of Israel. He sees Jesus on the right hand of God. Stephen's testimony is rejected and he is stoned to death.
And then if I can have another person read chapter 8 and 9.
Saul persecutes the church, Philip's ministry in Samaria is spread, Philip performs miracles and baptizes men. Peter and John come to Samaria to confer the gift of the Holy Ghost by laying on hands. Simon seeks the body of Philip's gift and is rebuked by Peter. Philip preaches about Christ and baptizes an Ethiopian eunuch. Jesus appears to Saul. Saul has chosen a vessel. And Ananias restores Saul's sight. Saul is baptized and begins his ministry. Peter heals Ananias and raises Dorcas from death.
Thank you. Okay, so we're going to pause here because I do want to briefly mention Paul. We're going to learn a lot more about him later. But the Apostle Paul, he also was Saul. That was his name. And Paul was actually a Pharisee, and he persecuted Christians, like slaughtering people who were in the early days, early Christians. What happened was he ended up seeing a vision of Jesus that changed his life, and he had a complete conversion where he was baptized. And he did become a missionary, and he helped to spread the gospel. And we'll later find out that in his later life, he is taken as a prisoner, and he does die a martyr. But I wanted to mention him because he is a big part of the New Testament. So we are going to stop here. We're actually going to learn about Stephen, I'm going to say his name. He is someone that I love to learn about because I don't think that we know enough about him if you haven't read the scriptures. Like if someone taught it to you, then you knew or you read it, then yes. But his martyrdom was something that is very important, I think, when we look through the Savior's eyes and how he was sharing the gospel to people. So a little bit about Stephen and his martyrdom was that he was a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and he did many wonders and miracles, but he had disputes with the Jews. And he is brought to trial, and I'll explain a little bit more after we watch the video.
Truth. and from thy kindred, and come into the land which I shall show thee. Then came he out of the land of the Chaldeans, and dwelt in Haran, and from thence, when his father was dead, he removed him into this land, wherein he now dwelt, and he gave him none inheritance of him. No, not so much as to set his foot on it, yet he promised that he would give it to him for possession, and to his seed after him, when as yet he had no child. And God spake on this wise, that his seed should sojourn in a strange land, and that they should bring them into bondage for 400 years. But when the time of the promise drew nigh, which God had sworn unto Abraham, the people grew and multiplied in Egypt, in which time Moses was born. And Moses was learned in all the wisdom of the Egyptians, and was mighty in words and in deeds. And when he was full of 40 years old, it came into his heart to visit his brethren, the children of Israel. This is that Moses which said unto the children of Israel, A prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren. Like unto me, him shall ye hear. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness with the angel which spake to him in the Mount Sinai, and with our fathers who received the like oracles to give unto us, to whom our fathers would not obey, but thrust him from them, and in their hearts turned back again into Egypt, saying unto Aaron, Make us gods to go before us. For as for this Moses, which brought us out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what has become of him. And they made a calf in those days, and offered sacrifice to the idol, and rejoiced in the works of their own hands. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them from Shur before the coming of the just one, of whom ye have been now betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the disposition of angels, and have not kept it. Thank you.
things that he says. He's the first to proclaim that the law of Moses was fulfilled in Christ. And I wanted to mention this because in the law of Moses, what the Israelites had to do to atone for their sins, they had to do offerings. It would be a sin offering, it would be a grain offering, and they would bring this all to the tabernacle. And these offerings had to be like the best of the best of their harvest. It had to be the first fruits of their labor, so their wheat harvest, their grain. If they were going to bring the cattle to the slaughter, it had to be one without blemish. But in the New Testament, we see that the prophecy of Jesus' birth is now fulfilled, and Jesus becomes that ransom sacrifice, meaning Jesus is holy, he's unspotted, he's unblemished, he committed no sin, he was completely obedient to all of the commandments, and he fulfilled that law of Moses because he went and he was that sacrifice. So that's what I wanted to mention about Stephen and how people think that the law of Moses was fulfilled in Christ, because the people in this time didn't understand what that meant. What he also did is that he pointed out that those Israelites who were under the law of Moses, they also persecuted prophets, meaning the Lord had sent prophets to the people, and some of these prophets were persecuted. So he was stoned to death, and I think that we find a similarity in what happens when he dies or he's killed, is that he actually asks for the people to be forgiven. And I think that makes me wonder, when I encounter hostility or contention or opposition, how do I treat those individuals? So, yeah, this is Stephen's story, and if you're interested in reading more about it, I definitely recommend reading through the book of Acts. So, we may not be persecuted in this way. Maybe we don't find opposition in the same way, such as Peter, where he gets arrested and beaten, or stoned to death by Stephen. But what can I say to someone who left the church because they were hurt or offended by a member or leader in our church? Yeah.
In most cases, the only thing I think that applies is just welcome, because they have seen a really bad side that they think is a church. It's not the church, but it's someone who's representing the church. And so they need to see from us as a representative that there's still a lot of different church to be found, and it's not every single person that's going to be there.
Yeah. I thought this was a relevant question for all of us. I've had individuals tell me that they were leaving the church and they didn't want the church to follow them, or they just, you know, disagree with different principles that the church teaches, maybe disagree with, you know, gospel doctrine, and I understand, right? So I'm curious for them not to say no.
Can I actually raise someone who's experienced it before?
Absolutely. But yeah, keep inviting people back, even if you know that they were hurt or offended. Maybe gently nudging them or encouraging them with what the gospel teaches. We want to be Christ-like communities. We don't want to force it on them. Sister Brandy.
I love this quote from Elder Holland. Except in the case of his only perfect begotten son, imperfect people are all God has ever had to work with, he said. That must be terribly frustrating to him, but he deals with it. So should we. And when you see imperfection, remember that the limitation is not in the divinity of the work.
Thank you, Sister Brandy. Yes, I remember
brothers and sisters, that the people don't make up the church. This is God's house. God makes up the church. Jesus is the church, not the people. Like I heard you say, we make mistakes. I know his mom, Noah. Been a member for over 26 years, at least. And for 16 of those years, I walked away from the church. Took off my garments, folded them up, put them in a drawer, and closed it. For 16 years, I was gone. For 16 years, everywhere I moved, my records went. I would say 5 years ago, I was prompted to come back on my own. I probably had influences by good people. And then probably people that weren't members, oh, you're an LDS? Oh, you go to church? Okay, well, no, I don't go to church, but I'm not active. And I think though that was the Holy Ghost prompting me to come back. When I came back, one of the lessons that day, the very first day when I came back, was something similar to this. And they talked about ministering. It was with a bunch of women in a room, Relief Society. And she talked about ministering, and she asked a question. And then she asked somebody to stand, you know, raise your hand, and so I'll put my hand. And everyone thought, oh, you're new. Oh, you're visiting. Oh, well, who are you? I belong to this ward. I'm your sister. This is my home ward. I've been a member for 26 years. 16 years I've walked away. Where have you been? So do not give up on those brothers and sisters. You make sure to tell them, remind them every single time you visit them. If they're in that position, remember, they're human. They make mistakes. We're imperfect. God doesn't want perfect people in church. He wants imperfect people. Otherwise, why do we need to be here for perfect, right? Only one person, right? Don't give up reminding them it's God's house. Jesus makes a church. It's his foundation, not the people. We're here to learn to be more Christ-like. So remember that when you're out there ministering to someone who's offended or walked away.
Thank you. Sure. Always looking at that effect. We need to be reminded that it's not just an effort by the missionaries to fellowship, but it's also our responsibility as members to reach out to those who are inactive and be welcoming and be encouraging. We don't want to be condemning. Thank you. Who else wants to comment?
There's something that I heard along my mission was always there's a reason why you go on your mission and a reason why you stay. I think it kind of applies to the same to church. Like, there's a reason why you come to the church in the beginning and there's a reason why you stay. help them understand why it's important to study. Mm-hmm. They might come for the activities, they might come because they feel a sense of friendship with the members, but the most important thing we can do to help them come back and help them stay is to find the reason that that's in Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we want to put that focus back onto the Savior. I think it's interesting because there's a lot of topics that are taboo that maybe need to be addressed, but we kind of don't know how to talk about them. I know that some of our church leaders have mentioned that there's a lot of young single adults, and I mean in general, many other individuals who are not young and single adults, but that they're walking away from their church or their faith for whatever reason, right? And it's interesting because I think that we're learning little by little how can we address these common misconceptions about the church. And how can we respond when we know there's a vent or someone who is hurt? And I think the answer is always along the same lines of drawing near to the Savior, keeping the focus on the Lord, praying about how you can be a better disciple of Christ. So thank you. Anyone else want to comment? So I think we had a really good discussion. There's so much that we're going to be learning about in the book of Acts. So I'm eager to continue in our study. So I hope that you are motivated and encouraged to read, even if it's just a paragraph. It doesn't need to be a full chapter. But keep on making room for the Holy Ghost to be in your life. You want to make sure that the environment invites the Spirit. Keep on sharing the gospel with boldness. Even though we don't see Jesus Christ physically here in this room, he does direct his church through the Holy Ghost. And we are to liken the scriptures to our lives so that our hearts can be right in the sight of God. And when we do that, we become instruments inviting others to Jesus Christ. And I want to say that with boldness, in the name of our Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Thank you, everyone, for all of your participation. Thanks for bearing with me and our technology issues. We will have a closing prayer by Sister Pat. Yes, ma'am. Thank you.